In the event of catastrophe, can there be any defense against nuclear weapons?
Civil defense can be readily justifiable as insurance for the civilian population in case of an enemy miscalculation. It is insurance we trust will never be needed, but insurance which we could never forgive ourselves for foregoing in the event of catastrophe.
In 1961, President Kennedy promised to develop civil defense. What's happened since then? In the Pentagon, the director of the Civil Defense Preparedness Agency describes the status of today's program, Bardyl Tirana.
If there were a threat of nuclear attack today, and there is not, the civil defense planning that has taken place over the last 29 years would not accomplish very much in terms of protection of American lives.
And in the State Department, Paul Warnke, the director of the Arms Control and Disarmament Agency, doesn't even believe it's possible to have effective civil defense against today's arsenals.
Given the fact that we have in excess of 8,000 individually deliverable nuclear weapons, and the Soviet Union has maybe half that, that you can't even find enough targets on which those nuclear warheads could usefully be employed. Now, under those circumstances, I think to talk about civil defense as enabling you to survive a nuclear war is indulging optimism to the point of total folly.
Is survival impossible today? Would we be annihilated? Even Dr. Samuel Glasstone, one of the world's leading authorities on nuclear weapons, is unsure.
Having worked on the effects of nuclear weapons for almost 30 years now, I feel more and more that getting involved in a nuclear war would be the most horrible experience that we could imagine. Whether it's survivable or not depends. In some circumstances, no doubt some people would survive. But I wonder what kind of world they would survive to live in.
Hiroshima. A bomb called Little Boy, dropped on August 6, 1945, did this. The initial explosion was followed by 6 hours of fire and then a black rain, a mixture of ashes, water, and radioactive debris. By year's end, 140,000 had died. Little Boy was aptly named, for today's weapons are 1,000 times more powerful.
Let us suppose that a nuclear weapon is fired in the air. The first thing that happens is that a extremely hot mass of the weapon, the residues, is formed with a temperature that's hotter than the interior of the sun and extremely high pressure. And this hot mass immediately starts to expand and engulfs the air around it and forms an very hot fireball. Now, the fireball produces three effects. One, it causes a blast wave to travel from the point of the explosion out to great distances through the air. Now, this is very much like the blast wave from a regular conventional explosion, except it is very, very much more powerful. The second effect is something that does not occur with an ordinary high explosive explosion. It is the emission of thermal radiation. This is a kind of heat radiation that comes out from the fireball.
Thermal radiation moving at the speed of light casts strange permanent shadows at Hiroshima. Objects up to 2 miles from the fireball were burned, but only on the side facing the explosion. Intervening objects formed heat shields, an effect that came to be known as shadowing.
The main effect is on people. Only, however, if their bodies are exposed to the radiation. Any part of the body which is covered, especially by some light material, will be completely unaffected. In Japan, there were examples of people who wore striped clothing, and where the clothing was dark stripes, absorbed radiation caused burns, but the white stripes did not. There were a considerable number of thermal radiation burns in Japan, largely because the weather was warm and people were out of doors and had rather light clothing. Another effect, of course, is the effect of the nuclear radiation. And this, although it is not as important as the other effects of nuclear explosions, is of major interest because it is something that is rather new in warfare and something which people do not understand.
Nuclear radiation is silent and invisible. The chain reaction of the bomb produces neutrons and gamma rays. The bodies of people not shielded by several feet of earth or concrete will absorb this radiation. Living cells are damaged or destroyed. The degree of destruction depends on the dose of radiation that is absorbed. This determines life or death. In Hiroshima, some of the survivors of the blast and fire suffered a new disease, radiation sickness. The symptoms were nausea, high fever, diarrhea, and bleeding. Disease resistance was lowered. The hair fell out. When death occurred, it was within days or weeks. The ruined city itself was left radioactive by products of the nuclear reaction. Those who re-entered the city were irradiated. Radiation doses too low to cause immediate death have produced leukemia and cancers years later. In tests after the war, fallout was investigated. A groundburst produces large quantities of radioactive debris that fall back into the target area and heavily contaminate it. This is called fallout. Hydrogen bombs, thousands of times more powerful than Little Boy, could sometimes spread fallout for hundreds of miles, depending on weather conditions. Radioactive debris, iodine-131, strontium-90, were detected circling the globe, carried on the air currents of the upper atmosphere. In Hiroshima, amidst the vast destruction, some structures, those made of reinforced concrete and steel, remain standing. And some people sheltered in basements survived close to ground zero. Trolley cars were running again in 3 days. Electrical power was restored in many areas the day after the blast. It seemed the defense against these new weapons might be possible. So in Nevada during the 50s, a series of tests was conducted on typical American structures. protect against blast, the major lesson, get people away from the center. A 1 megaton explosion damages about a 200 square mile area. There is near total destruction in the center. Few people, if any, would survive. But this area covers only about 12 square miles. Within the orange circle, damage will still be severe, as shown in this retouched photograph. There will be many survivors, but few would be uninjured. Damage in the blue area is less severe. It is believed that most people in the area would survive if they took shelter in basements. The green circle covers nearly two-thirds of the total area affected, and there is not much visible damage. Fragile elements like this sign are bent or broken. A single-family brick or frame house might suffer heavy damage, but basements would again offer sufficient shelter for people. Learning about the effects of nuclear weapons became important because we were not the only country to have nuclear weapons. The Russians had tested their first atomic bomb in 1949. By the early 1950s, both nations were developing nuclear arsenals. The period known as the Cold War began. For the first time in American history, we were within striking distance by another country. Russian bombers could reach us with only 8 hours' warning. Volunteer civil defense teams grew up everywhere. 5 annual nationwide civil defense rehearsals were held. Evacuation, to get us out of town, away from the center of the blast. For example, Portland, Oregon, 100,000 people in 3 hours. Or in case of surprise attack, air raid drills to show us how to protect ourselves, at least against thermal radiation and flying debris. A fear was growing, and it was nurtured by a growing conflict in Europe. The Berlin crisis of 1961 brought the U.S. and Russia to the edge of the kind of tensions that can lead to war. After Berlin, the U.S. undertook a massive program to identify public places which could be used as fallout shelters. They were looking for 2 feet of concrete or 3 feet of earth, sufficient to protect against immediate radiation, although not necessarily against blast. Over 1 million private shelters were also built, costing as much as $2,800 apiece. Public shelters were stocked with medicines and food. Fallout loses its radioactivity rapidly at first. A 2-week stay below was judged sufficient to allow the contaminated ruins above to cool off. Then came the most frightening crisis of the early 60s. Fidel Castro signed a friendship pact with our enemy, the Soviet Union. In October 1962, spy planes discovered Soviet missiles and bombers in Cuba. President Kennedy blockaded the island. America mobilized for war, a nuclear war. Civilians panicked. Grocery stores were stripped. Children kept home. Over 10 million people left the cities on their own initiative in preparation for nuclear war. But when the Russians at last backed down, a lesson had been learned in Washington.
Then the Cuban Missile Crisis came along, and the United States learned that its nuclear deterrent at that time was so effective that not only was the United States protected, but that the Russians would have to back down. And at that point, the nation began to disregard civil defense because it was not then necessary.
Cuba proved that we had the military might to deter the Russians, but it also showed that civil defense was not sufficiently clear-cut in its goals to cope with the mobilization of 200 million people. White House advisors convinced Kennedy that civil defense as insurance for the people was not possible. Blast protection was too expensive. Comprehensive evacuation planning would require a regimentation of society. And the chances of it all working against growing numbers of nuclear weapons were becoming doubtful.
This administration has been looking hard at exactly what civil defense can and cannot do. It cannot be attained cheaply.
It cannot give an assurance of blast protection that will be proof against surprise attack or guaranteed against obsolescence or destruction. And it cannot deter a nuclear attack. We will deter an enemy from making a nuclear attack only if our retaliatory power is so strong and so invulnerable that he knows he would be destroyed by our response. If we have that strength, civil defense is not needed to deter an attack. If we should ever lack it, civil defense would not be an adequate substitute.
The 60s was the decade of the arms race. By the early 70s, both nations had arsenals and warheads in the thousands. Even though America stayed in front, Russian strength was clearly at the point where they could heavily damage the United States. And so deterrence became mutual. The strategists called it mutual assured destruction. It rested on the idea that no defense was possible against such vast arsenals. So each side held the other's cities and population hostage. Whoever started the war, destruction of both sides was inevitable. But this belief in the inevitability of mutual assured destruction was not adhered to by everyone. General Graham, the former director of the Defense Intelligence Agency, has always been a strong opponent.
Well, mutual assured destruction, probably with the best acronym in the world, MAD, is, I think, immoral because for the first time in the history of the United States, the defense of the United States is dependent upon the slaughter of civilians in another country. Even worse, it's dependent upon the potential slaughter of our own men, women, and children, non-combatants. That, to me, is a basically immoral doctrine.
Now, there have been those that say that our present doctrine of mutual assured destruction is, in fact, what the acronym would spell, a MAD policy. I submit, however, that no one has thought of a better or more effective way of preventing nuclear war. It's better and more effective because it accepts the inevitable logic of strategic nuclear weapons, which is that strategic nuclear weapons are not warfare implements that can be utilized to promote any sort of political objective. It's a doomsday weapon.
In 1972, the first Strategic Arms Limitation Treaty, or SALT, was signed for a 5-year period. One of the treaty's most significant accomplishments was the limiting of anti-ballistic missile defenses. This reinforced the doctrine that defense was impossible against nuclear weapons. But as SALT 1 came to an end in 1977, a secret intelligence study called the Team B Report claimed that the Russians had used the past years under SALT to disrupt the balance and were trying to gain strategic superiority. General Graham was a member of Team B.
For the first time in the history of the United States, you have a hostile power that wishes to destroy your political and economic institutions and has the wherewithal to do it.
The Soviets have indeed caught up and even surpassed us in numbers of bombers and missiles, while we have actually subtracted from some parts of our arsenal. But we still have more than twice as many warheads. General Graham and others say that the Russians have added something else to the strategic equation, civil defense. While we cut back on our program, they continued to build theirs. Could this mean that they have never accepted the logic of MAD, that they believe a nuclear war can be won?
Когда вы в первый раз встретились с гражданской обороной?
Dr. Leon Goure, director of Soviet studies at the University of Miami, is one of the few Americans who has continued to study Russian civil defense. Much of his information has come from Russian emigres.
Professor Gochman is having an interview with me on his experiences in Russia on civil defense. He was, as a matter of fact, my very first person I interviewed. Было ли убежище тоже в вашей школе или в институте, где вы работали?
Ну, в институте было массу подвальных помещений, в которых
I asked him whether there were shelters at the institute where he worked. He said that there was a large complex of basements in that institute. There were steel doors, multiple steel doors. This wasn't Moscow. I asked him whether the subway in Moscow had been adapted for shelter purposes, and he said that at the bottom of the staircase, at the entrances to the platforms, there were glass doors, and that clearly they were very heavy doors and therefore intended to isolate the station from the outside for blast purposes.
Recently, U.S. intelligence agencies have shown increased interest in the information gathered by the few unofficial civil defense analysts. Harriet Scott spent several years in Moscow when her husband was Air Force attaché at the U.S. Embassy. She acquired possibly the largest private library on the Soviet military and an expert knowledge of their civil defense.
In 1956, they started the first phase of civil defense education of the population. This was purely explaining to the people about nuclear weapons and the nuclear effects and really what it's all about, you know, what an atom is, how it's made up, and what the results are. And this was completed in about 3 years, and then they started a second phase, which was reading about what the population should do, what they should do as citizens in civil defense, and what they should learn, what their actions should be, learning about the signals of civil defense. And most of that was in papers called the various, it was a 21-hour course, and then they had a 19-hour course. And then in 1967, they went into the third phase of civil defense education, which was practicing, taking a combination of what the book learning and then going out and doing actual exercises.
Phase one, the basic facts of nuclear weapons as described in Harriet Scott's collection of Russian training posters. The effects of blast were described. The behavior of thermal radiation. Fallout patterns and weather conditions. Russians believe that in Hiroshima, many people died through panic or ignorance. Public education is the key. The causes and symptoms of radiation sickness are explained. What are procedures during a crisis?
Now, hopefully, civil defense envisages a certain period, several days perhaps, when it would look like a tense situation and they would have indications that an attack would be imminent and they could take all sorts of precautions that they wouldn't be able to do otherwise.
Precaution number one is evacuation. Get away from the target areas and into the countryside. Organization is crucial.
Civil defense is generally organized by the place of business, place of work where the people are, by factories and industries and things like that. And most of that side is the workers are civilians, and they're made up in teams, and then they have all sorts of duties that they're supposed to provide food and evacuation and things like that.
Evacuation uses all available transport. When that runs out, you walk. Evacuees have prearranged reception areas, and it seems that these are not just paper plans. People know about them.
There was an article not long ago about the man who had taken his family out to the area and actually visited the family that, in the house where he was assigned. And they said this way they got to know each other and, looking forward to, I don't know if they actually looked forward to it, but they became friends in case if that emergency that they would have to go and stay with them.
Shelters may be available in the countryside or on the farms, or it may be necessary to build them out of wood or earth. They're called expedient shelters. The emphasis is on simplicity. Walk out of town, then dig. What happens in a surprise attack? Find any shelter, a ditch, a culvert, behind a wall. All will protect you by absorbing some nuclear and thermal radiation. Keep eyes covered and wait. After the attack, recovery. Reconnaissance parties cautiously enter the damaged cities. Radiation levels must be checked before rescue work can start. Much of the dangerous work is a military responsibility.
The whole of the Soviet Union is divided into 16 military districts. Each of these military districts then has a general officer that's in charge of the civil defense in that area. And the troops of civil defense are actually, I guess, located in each city. And it's their job to perform what they call snabber work, which is urgent rescue and emergency relief work.
Gas masks prevent inhalation of fallout dust. Decontamination moves ahead. The plans cover all aspects of a nuclear war. But how many people could really carry them out? How widespread is this planning?
I estimate that there are probably 50,000 officers and military involved in the civilian side of civil defense. And then on the other side of civil defense, the military side of civil defense, it looks like there's another 50,000. So I estimate altogether that 100,000 military, active duty military people are involved every day in civil defense.
The basic task of public education is accomplished with this booklet. 60 million have been printed. And magazines monitored by Harriet Scott regularly report civil defense exercises. Workers entering this fallout shelter were photographed by Dr. Goure, and he also saw this ventilation shaft cover on a Moscow street. Underneath is almost certainly a shelter like this. They've been compulsory for new Moscow buildings since 1972.
The Soviets regard civil defense as a factor, as they say, of great strategic significance, without which a state can not only not survive a war, but win a war. Since the Russian belief both in the possibility of surviving a war and winning a war, nuclear war, it is, of course, important to protect all the elements which will maintain national power, which is population, especially, of course, the more valuable part of the population, and again, the valuable parts of the economy. Out of this, the Soviets say that if they can carry out their civil defense measures in full, casualties will be kept at 4 to 6% approximately of the urban population.
Protecting the population is the first element of Russian civil defense. But the second element is just as important, protecting industry. Here at Boeing Aerospace in Seattle, a team headed by systems analyst T.K. Jones has carved out a detailed study of Soviet industrial hardening methods. Briefings like this have been presented to congressional committees, the Pentagon, the executive branch, and various government agencies.
Now, once again, rule one for protection of Russian industry is to spread it out. And this chart shows a sample of what the Russians are starting to do in spreading out some of their industry. Now, if you compare that, for example, with the kind of dispersal that we do in the United States, the blue shows our primary machining complex. Notice, for example, that the buildings are large, they're packed in closely together. It takes approximately 8 times the megatonnage per square foot of floor space to destroy the Russian complex as it takes to destroy ours. Rule two is to toughen things up just a little bit. The Russian approach is to protect their machinery. By simply packing a machine tool with sandbags or dirt, they fireproof it, they protect it from debris, and they improve its blast resistance by 4 to 8 times. This particular chart was taken from a training exercise reported in a Soviet factory. It indicates that it took a 10-man crew about 5.3 hours to bag up this machine. Now, we here had a lot of reservations about the practicality as well as the effectiveness of these protective measures. We didn't know all that much about what the Russians were really doing to protect their stuff. So what we did was to take their literature describing what they were going to do and give it to the gentleman that ran our factory. We asked him to please read their literature and then step by step proceed through a plan outlining how we would apply the Russian methods to protect an American factory.
Boeing's Auburn complex is one of the largest industrial facilities in the world. This autoclave, used in the heat treatment of large aircraft components, would be crucial for quick recovery. In the Russian method, it would be entirely covered with 6 feet of dirt, as would the other vital machinery. But who would do the work? How long would it take? The team counted the number of people and cars on a shift. They calculated the time to travel to areas where they could get the necessary dirt. All the essential items could be protected in a total of 48 hours, so long as there were enough shovels to go around. Dirt is the key element. But for better protection against the heaviest weapons, the Russians advised packing the machines first in crushable materials. At Boeing, aluminum metal chips were the perfect answer. Members of the team bagged them for use in the explosive tests they have conducted in conjunction with defense agencies at White Sands, New Mexico. This test film shows them burying their trial objects with bags of chips and the essential dirt. 500 tons of conventional explosive will be detonated close to the burial site, equivalent to a 1 megaton blast just 2,000 feet away. The aftermath shows success. A small grinding machine, still usable with only minor damage. A motorcycle, as delicate as any machine tool, in working order. And they say there's no reason why the methods should not work at full scale. Nova was given this map of the industrial layout of a Russian city. The source, an expert in military targeting, said that 8 1-megaton weapons could destroy it all if it were left unprotected. But he claimed if Russian methods of hardening were applied fully, 110 1-megaton weapons could destroy only 50% of the industrial capacity. And it could be back to normal within 2 to 4 years. But such impressive conclusions, both for industrial hardening and population protection, are hotly debated. Director of the Stanford Linear Accelerator in California, Dr. Wolfgang Panofsky.
Those who make detailed calculations which predict in detail that suddenly 100 million Soviets will all march out, build shelters which have a certain protection factors, have all these shelters beforehand stocked with food, even though the Soviet Union does not have an abundance of food, in fact has food problems even at peacetime, all these people simply rely on perfectly meaningless calculations which ignore the human element which exists in the Soviet Union just as much as it does in the United States.
The critics dispute particularly the extent to which Russian civil defense plans can be applied. They claim that there are nothing like enough trained workers to handle the evacuation of 160 million city dwellers and achieve a 90% success rate, that the numbers of available trucks, buses, and trains are hopelessly inadequate, that walking and digging expedient shelters in the Russian winter would be extremely difficult, if not impossible. But T.K. Jones looks to history for support.
In the 1940-41 time period, the Russians evacuated many of their major cities and over 1,800 industries in the face of a German invasion. It would appear unrealistic to assume that today they couldn't do something that they clearly demonstrated they could do before. But more fundamental is that the Soviet plans to get their people out are very, very simple. And because they are simple, we have high confidence that they would work.
In order to really make any difference to the outcome of nuclear war, the Soviets would have to protect their industry on an enormous scale. It doesn't do any good if indeed that kind of exercise gets carried out in 1% or 0.5% or 2% of the industrial establishment. Now, the industrial establishment is a system. It is not just some machine tools or transformers, but an overall living system of interconnected elements. Now, there's no evidence known to me that the Soviets are indeed engaged in any large-scale industrial hardening. There's no evidence known to me at all that the Soviets have tried to decentralize their heavy industry or to pay attention to civil defense consideration in location of new plants.
T.K. Jones has shown us the layout of a Soviet plant that is spread out. but he could not estimate the number of factories in the Soviet Union that were actually dispersed this way. And although Professor Gockman has described blast shelters in factories and in subway stations, again, the actual numbers of such places are not known. In fact, the only indications of mass interest in civil defense are the millions of copies of civil defense books and pamphlets that have been distributed, and the weekly magazine and newspaper reports. The overall intelligence picture is not available publicly. All of the people we interviewed had at least some access to classified information, but they interpreted it differently. Such arguments are even going on between the intelligence agencies themselves. The degree to which the Soviet Union has carried out its civil defense planning remains unclear. A strong Soviet civil defense program could mean that they don't believe in mutual assured destruction. They are not going to hold their population as hostages. Where does that leave us? Are we alone in jeopardizing our people? What sort of protection do we offer today in the event of catastrophe? We do protect our military and political leadership. The Strategic Air Command has its main headquarters in a deep underground blast shelter. They can also operate from a series of Boeing jets, from which they will be able to telephone the president in his jet. And this is a shelter set up to protect civilians. It's one of the regional headquarters of the Defense Civil Preparedness Agency, a sophisticated underground bunker, not for the population, but for administrators who are supposed to help see us through a nuclear war. This center in Maynard, Massachusetts, will tell the state leaders of New England, New York, and Puerto Rico when a war is imminent, and they will issue information before the attack telling people how to protect themselves. During the war, they act as an information service for state and local leaders. There are 9 such regional centers, although not many as well protected as this one.
Region 1, test.
FPA-1.
FPA-1, test.
The Federal Preparedness Agency is another government bureau involved in civil defense. They will join the people in the bunker at Maynard in time of war. Their job is a big one, to reconstitute national government and get the economy going after the war is over. The information they will need is held in this computer. How many targets have been hit? How many people are left? How many airports and roads are still usable? The present listings are simulated. How will the information be fed into the computer in time of war?
I suspect this would start down at the very local level in any locality, down at the town, the county level, where they had people working with civil defense who would actually, first of all, would hear a bomb drop, perhaps, see it at some distance, and would try to judge then what size bomb it was and where it was located. They would then, either by messenger or by telephone this to the state headquarters. The state headquarters, in turn, would relay it to the Federal Regional Center at Maynard, either by telephone or teletype or whatever, radio, any facilities they had and that were available at that time that were still operable, could be used.
Mr. Bassett is optimistic about our chances for national recovery.
This idea that we're going to be wiped out and nothing can happen and we might just as well give up if we have a bombing is not right, because we can reconstitute federal government. We can have a viable government. You go back 20 or 30 years and you think of the numbers of people that we had in this government. We didn't have the 210 million people that we now have. Sure, maybe we'd be living at a lower level of economy, but we'd have enough people. Maybe we'd have to go back to a 1920 status of people and numbers and economy, maybe earlier than that. But we've got enough people, and we've got enough people in the federal government who know how to do things and know their responsibilities so that we could have a viable government again.
Mr. Zenowitz, director of the Maynard Center, is somewhat less optimistic.
As I look at my watch now, and if we receive news in about 15 or 20 minutes that there was an enemy attack pending, I regret to inform you that I do not feel that we are prepared to protect Mr. and Mrs. America in the street.
Our public fallout shelters are still there, but we no longer hold shelter exercises in them. And the food and medical stockpiles were never renewed. Most of the $153 million worth of crackers and other food supplies became rancid. Some were used for pig fodder, some were sent for famine relief. The drugs and Geiger counters have been removed for fear of theft. People are no longer building their own private shelters. There are no more evacuation rehearsals. But civil defense on a local volunteer level, particularly for peacetime emergencies, is still a strong force in many communities.
We do know that people who have had great experience in man-made or natural disasters, especially natural disasters, and have trained and had evacuations and of that sort and set up tent cities and handled emergency communications and warning, they are the people who will survive or have a greater chance of survival. There is no instant civil defense. It takes training, and natural disasters are the field for training.
This is the Lubbock Operational Area Emergency Broadcast System.
Natural disasters occur with suddenness and ferocity. The DCPA puts out books like this. Lubbock, Texas had recently had a training session for emergency preparedness. When a series of tornadoes destroyed their downtown area, their police and fire stations, and left 26 people dead and thousands homeless, they were prepared to deal with the crisis smoothly. More than 25,000 natural disasters occur yearly. People cooperate in taking care of the injured and in rebuilding quickly. But it's usually one area at a time. What if the whole country, all the major cities and resources, was affected? The best answer would be to be somewhere else. Like the Russians, our civil defense agency believes evacuation is essential to effective civilian protection. Dr. Chipman is responsible for DCPA's crisis relocation planning.
The map behind me shows the potential risk areas in the United States. You'll notice out in the west, in Dakotas, Montana, large red areas. These represent the areas that could be exposed to nuclear blast as a result of an attack on the missile fields, the Minuteman intercontinental missiles. There are other larger red areas in the east. These, of course, represent the large metropolitan areas. And then there are a number of smaller red areas across the country, and these are the smaller metropolitan areas. Basically, what we're looking at then are the bomber bases, the intercontinental ballistic missile fields, and virtually all cities of 50,000 or greater. These are places which could be hit in a large-scale attack.
Just 140 cities contain over 50% of the American population, while 95% of the land area is thought to be safe from nuclear attack. In the countryside, it would be relatively simple to provide fallout shelter protection, whereas providing blast protection in cities is vastly more difficult and expensive. But there are some obvious problems. Normal traffic creates traffic jams. Evacuation traffic would be virtually unimaginable. And at the moment, only one or two cities have evacuation plans. They're relatively small cities. Planning goes slowly because there is not much money. What could civil defense accomplish in this country? A recent study, PONAS 2, claimed that we would have high population losses without more effective civil defense programs, but that with national evacuation plans and an updated fallout shelter program, 93% of all Americans could survive a nuclear attack. The problem? Cost. PONAS's price tag? $12 billion, or about $50 per person. Today's civil defense budget is $90 million, or about 50 cents per person. Although different studies have come up with different price tags, all of them have been beyond the reach of this budget, and these costs only evacuate and shelter us. National recovery would mean an industrial hardening program as well.
We found that in looking at our area and applying the Soviet methods to protecting this area, that we could protect ourselves quite well. By moving out our people and sheltering them, we can protect them. By protecting our machinery, we can get our recovery time down to where we can restart production in something like 4 to 12 weeks, and we can be back at present levels of production in about 1 year.
But in the fall of 1976, the Joint Congressional Committee on Defense Production rejected any move toward a national industrial protection program and called it too costly. T.K. Jones, who testified before the committee, disagrees.
We estimated what it would cost to provide a reasonable level of protection for all the industry in the United States, and that cost was like $2.5 to $3 billion. Now, that's maybe half of the amount that U.S. industry today spends every year just to insure itself from other hazards. And therefore, we would certainly not regard that as an insurmountable cost by any means.
But the committee felt it could not adequately judge costs when there were still some important gaps in our knowledge. Burying certain kinds of machinery is possible. But other key elements, like refineries, cannot be protected in this way.
Now, the results of the study that we came out with, we believe, are fully applicable to other U.S. industries, certainly the other elements of the aerospace industry. But the kind of protective methods we found would work for us would also work for the machine tool industry, the automotive industry, and others similar to that. We had suggested that some of the other industries would require different kinds of protection, such as refining, for example, and electrical power production should do studies comparable to the ones that we did.
On balance, I think that the threat of nuclear war is so large that national survival, survival of our society and form of government as we now know it, is very much in doubt, and I have serious question as to whether survival is possible without an enormous expenditure of funds, which I don't think this nation is prepared to do at this time.
Now, I have gotten estimates out of people who handle civil defense for the Pentagon, which says that for $1.25 a head, you know, for every man, woman, and child in the United States, you can come up with a system, a plan that, given some warning, you could save 100 million Americans' casualties in the event of a nuclear war. That's at $1.25 a head, but let's say they're wrong and it's twice that much, 2.5 a head. Well, compare that with what the American people are putting into a metro system here in Washington to move bureaucrats around, okay? You just take the price of that thing, which is over $5 billion, divide the population into it, and you find that it's about $25 a head that that our great leaders are willing to put into the proposition of moving bureaucrats around in Washington.
Some countries, like Sweden, have developed civil defense programs at a cost of about $5 per person per year. Evacuation routes are located in every city's telephone book, along with lists of things to do. Every physically able person between 16 and 65 is liable to service in civil defense. There are blast shelters in the cities. Would such a program be possible in the United States? Some would suggest that the cost would not be so low in a country as urbanized and industrialized as we are, with a population 30 times as large as Sweden's, and with the number of nuclear weapons that would be targeted against us in a war with Russia. But the Russians are interested enough in foreign civil defense that they have paid General Jeanmaire, the head of Switzerland's program, for classified information. The general was sentenced to 18 years for treason.
Le tribunal de division 2 a condamné Jean-Louis Jeanmaire.
Are the Russians and Europeans interested in civil defense because of tradition? Russia, after all, is surrounded by past enemies. Or are these programs designed to save lives in an all-out nuclear war? Does Russia's program give the lie, perhaps, to Russia's commitment to mutual assured destruction?
The SALT negotiations, of which I was a part, were predicated on the idea that we really had and could preserve mutual assured destruction as a means of deterring nuclear war. If the Soviet civil defenses worked, that is no longer as mutual as it once was. It's becoming, by and large, unilateral.
It would be dangerous if the Soviet Union believed that it had a civil defense program that could enable it to survive as a society after an American retaliatory strike. In my opinion, that would be so irrational for them to believe that I can't really accept the proposition that they believe it.
Well, the proposition that nuclear war would be so utterly destructive as to be unthinkable is, I don't think, will stand up either under empirical or technical analysis. You do have some empirical data. If you go to Hiroshima or Nagasaki today, except for that which has been preserved to show you that a nuclear weapon has been dropped there, you could never tell that a nuclear weapon was ever dropped there. If you go into the Japanese countryside around and see if it's destroyed their ability to raise rice or pigs or chickens or anything else, you find it simply isn't true. So what that school of thought does is to terrorize into a paralysis of action our own side of the equation. And regrettably, the Soviets don't do that. They have been saying all along that nuclear weapons are simply an advance in technology of weaponry, and they don't change anything.
Hiroshima and Nagasaki did survive and recover. Every year, they hold a memorial ceremony to remind them of their unique and terrifying experience. Their recovery has been a testimonial to man's ability to survive. A-bomb victims are still dying from the long-term effects of radiation, leukemias, and cancers, although scientists have been surprised to find that the extensive genetic effects they expected have not appeared. Yet, anyway. But Hiroshima and Nagasaki were only two cities and two small atomic weapons. Would a similar recovery be possible today? In Stockholm, Dr. Frank Barnaby, editor of a yearly anthology on world arms and armaments, and an expert in military technology, doubts the relevance of Hiroshima and Nagasaki to survival in a modern nuclear war.
It depends, firstly, what you mean by survive. The situation clearly is that if there were a nuclear war in which even a significant fraction of the 60,000 odd nuclear weapons that exist were used, then civilization as we know it would be destroyed. There wouldn't be a major city left in Europe or America. I mean, the northern hemisphere would be virtually obliterated. Damage done to Germany in World War II would be small compared with the damage that a nuclear war would do. Having said that, however, there clearly would be a fraction of the population that would survive the immediate event. But the question that one has then to ask is, what would be the long-term consequences of this Holocaust?
What if 10,000 one-megaton bombs with 700,000 times the power of Hiroshima's little boy were used on the 5,000 major cities in the Northern Hemisphere? What would be the effects of such a vast release of explosive energy and radiation on the environment? No one knows for sure, but one consequence of nuclear explosions is the production of oxides of nitrogen, which attack ozone particles. The ozone layer of the atmosphere protects us from ultraviolet radiation. Cancer, deaths of many kinds could result. Another possible effect is the heating up of the atmosphere through the enormous release of energy. One theory has it that the ice caps would melt, causing worldwide flooding. But it's all speculation.
Many people have the idea, and perhaps in some sense it's a comforting idea, that nuclear war is the end of the world, it's the end of civilization, it's on the beach, that no one would survive, not a man, not a woman, not a blade of grass. Actually, of course, as with most things, it's not like that. It's a question of degree. Depending on what we were to do in this country, civil defense-wise, and what all the people were to do, you might see a post-attack United States of 80 million or 110 million or perhaps 180 million Americans.
It is predictable, I would have thought, that even with such levels of civil defense, if all of your cities are destroyed, imagine it yourself. What sort of life would one live? Imagine waking up in the morning in an underground shelter, knowing that every city in the Northern Hemisphere was a flat, was obliterated.
Somebody has to survive. You know, we've had forms of nuclear holocaust ever since this world has been going. The volcano, I'm sure, to the early person in the Pacific Islands was the same as a nuclear weapon system. It destroyed his food, it has polluted his water, polluted his air, killed his children. He survived. Man just is built to survive.
One of our problems in the United States is the persistent notion among Americans that peace is a normal way, a normal set of circumstances for the war, for the world, and the war is an aberration. But in fact, there is probably not more than a handful of Americans alive who have ever lived a day of their life when the world was at peace, that there was no war going on somewhere.
Whether or not it is necessary, it depends on whether you consider it worth surviving a nuclear war. If you are convinced that there is going to be one, and you want to maximize your chance of living rather than surviving, I think one should make the distinction, then you do want to start digging fairly soon. So in a sense, I think civil defense in that context is necessary, so to speak. But I would frankly, personally doubt whether one would want to live after this event. I think that those that go into the shelters and do live are the unfortunate people. The fortunate ones are those in the center of town, which are vaporized.
This program was produced by WGBH Boston, which is solely responsible for its content. Major funding for NOVA is provided by this station and by other public television stations. Additional funding is provided by grants from Exxon Corporation and the National Science Foundation.